which is going to be there from 19 to 24, is on public policy and its practice. I'm very happy that Dr. Vinod Mishra and Toki have selected the participant coming across all the state and keeping the gender balance and social group balance so that we are inclusive in our efforts. Now, I will, as a preliminary remark to the follow-up discussion for the next 3 days, I will just give you the framework that we have placed this particular workshop. As I said, this is the workshop on policies and practice with a reference to the marginalized group. In marginalized group, we include scheduled caste, scheduled tribe, other backward class, nomadic, denotified tribe, women, particularly women coming from these four sections, physically handicapped, and of course, poor in general, irrespective of caste and religion and ethnic background. So our concern in this workshop is that the speaker will discuss the policies and the practices and the challenges that we have ahead of us about this marginalized group. Now, I will touch upon three to four points. First is, we are organizing this workshop on the name of Dr. Ambedkar. Therefore, I will first spend a couple of minutes to share with you how Dr. Ambedkar was responsible, singularly rather responsible for developing the policies for the discriminated communities and group. That is the scheduled caste, scheduled tribe, and others. Although he began with the scheduled caste and then it got extended to scheduled tribe, OBC, and the affirmative action policy for women and minorities. So that is the first point that I will share with you. Then I will share with you the nature of the policies developed for the marginalized group over a period of time. And then I will share with you the what are the limitations of this policy, how those policy can be improved, and what is the current status of the social group for which the policies are made, and what are the challenges. So I think I will cover all this within 35 to 40 minutes. Let me begin with Dr. Ambedkar's perspective on the social policies for the marginalized and discriminated group, and the actual achievement that he has made in realizing this policy. Dr. Ambedkar started his activities in 1919 after he came back from England. And then the 1919 is a very important landmark for Dr. Ambedkar. The British government at that time would send a team every 10 years to India to bring reform into the British India Government of India Act. You know, we were ruled under the Government of India British Act. The Queen's Act. So the British wanted to improve upon those acts. Act means it was a constitution as a matter of British constitution for India, in a way. So they will have after every 10 years come here to India, seek the opinion of ours and make some reform. So they came in, the South Bureau Committee came in 1919 and Dr. Ambedkar submitted a proposal to them about the problem of untouchables. And asked for certain policies. Now, he had 3-point program. One, he asked for an equal citizenship right for the untouchable, which they were not able to enjoy. Secondly, he wanted law against discrimination. Third, he wanted some sort of a policy whereby the scheduled caste will get, not scheduled caste word was not used at that time, only untouchable word was used. So some reservation in the job in government, military, education institution, and legislation. This was his demand. Then after 10 years, the one of the success of this intervention of Dr. Ambedkar was that the British government accepted the nomination of the scheduled caste on the state and central assemblies. That was the first achievement. Now you should remember that the Muslim and European Indian and the Anglo-Indians already had a political reservation in the state assemblies and central assemblies. In fact, the Muslim had a separate electorate through which they were the Muslim could be represented in the parliament and the state legislature. Untouchable did not have this political representation, so he finally got through nomination. And it is a very romance that Dr. Ambedkar himself was the beneficiary of this reservation. And in 1929 or 28, he was nominated as a scheduled untouchable representative of the Bombay State Assembly Council, as a matter of fact. 10 years later, in 1930, Simon Commission came. Ambedkar again submitted a memorandum because his demands were not met of representation of scheduled castes in the councils, in the parliament and state assembly through elections. He argued for an adult suffrage, not through nomination. Asked for the reservation of post in government job, military, police. Even in police, untouchable did not have jobs. And then reservation in education institute and fund for education. So in 1929, he submitted the proposal. Then the British government invited all the Indians in Britain on this reform in the British Constitution or Act. And there were, it is popularly known as Roundtable Conference. The student of political science will know. So there were Roundtable Conference in London where Indian participants were invited. British participants were there to make the reform in the British India Act. And Dr. Ambedkar was also invited. And there were 3 roundtable conferences, 1, 2, 3. It went on for 1 or 2 years. And it ultimately resulted into a British India Constitution, what is called 1935 Act. It was a comprehensive constitution. Now, I don't want to go into greater detail. I just want to tell that the achievement of Dr. Ambedkar was that he got political reservation for the scheduled caste. At that time, the scheduled caste word was used in the constitution. The castes which are included in the schedule were given political reservation through political reservation. I would not go into the history of the controversy between Ambedkar and Gandhiji. Ultimate output was that the scheduled caste got political reservation. Muslim already had the political reservation through separate electors. Dr. Ambedkar became the labor minister in the British government in 1942, and he became a labor minister up to 1946. In the Pune Pact, through which the untouchable got the political reservation, there was a provision that the effort will be made to reserve the give adequate representation to the scheduled caste in public services and education institutions. Dr. Ambedkar used that clause and wrote a letter to the Governor General that there should be reservation in the government services. I'm talking of 42, as it has been agreed in the Pune Pact between Ambedkar and Gandhiji. So the Viceroy accepted the reservation in government services and also reservation in a public education institution and some fund for the education development on the scheduled caste. So now you can see that from 1990 to 1942, Dr. Ambedkar got political reservation, reservation in job, reservation in education institution, and fund for educational development. There were 2 schemes were meant for the educational development of scheduled caste. One, the post-matric scholarship for the scheduled caste. Now we have that for scheduled caste and scheduled tribe, but it was for scheduled caste, that all the students who pass higher secondary and enter into college, they will get the scholarship. And then one overseas scholarship scheme was developed that the student would be sent to outside country to PhD. That was the Dr. Ambedkar's achievement. Now let us come to the constitution. In the constitution then, ultimate outcome in the constitution was negative and positive. The negative is that the political reservation for the religious minorities, that is Muslim, particularly European Union, Europeans, Indian and the Canadian Christian, their representation in the central legislature, in the parliament and state assembly was withdrawn. That was the very retrogative step. Now you can see the representation of the Muslim is very, very low, 4% or something in the parliament. So the reservation was withdrawn. But nomination for European, Indian and Anglo-Indian, I think, is kept. Now, as far as the scheduled caste and scheduled tribe is concerned, their policy was also to be withdrawn, but Dr. Ambedkar protested He, in fact, threatened to resign as the chairman of the conducting committee. So finally, the political reservation in job and education institution was retained for the scheduled caste. So that is the achievement of Dr. Ambedkar. So entire credit of present reservation policy goes to Dr. Ambedkar. Now, before that, of course, Shahu Maharaj from Maharashtra has introduced reservation in 1902. And also Sayajirao Gaikwad, the king of Baroda, also had some policy of reservation. They both were the king from OBC, other backward class. So they responded to, they did on their own. But to come to the point that the finally the Indian constitution made the provision for reservation for scheduled caste. Now, the reservation extended to scheduled tribe. Reservation extended to OBC. Now, this reservation of scheduled caste also was extended to tribe, that credit goes to Ambedkar. Even provision was made in the constitution to set up a Mandal commission and see whether reservation can be given to the OBC. This was again done at the cost of the other backward caste. It is a tragedy that the other backward caste student and other backward caste people do not recognize this. They even oppose Ambedkar and Ambedkar's ideology sometimes. This is the tragedy. This is the tragedy of the country also, that the communities which have suffered from caste discrimination and Brahminic ideology are also the part of promoting the Brahminic ideology. This is the tragedy. I don't want to go into great detail. The victim of caste system, they themselves join the ideology which support the caste system. There cannot be irony more than this. Okay. But Dr. Ambedkar was responsible for reservation for tribal. Tribal also do not recognize Dr. Ambedkar. Never celebrate his birthday. OBC also do not recognize Dr. Ambedkar's contribution. So, but nevertheless, reservation for scheduled caste, the policy for OBC and scheduled tribe is the effort of Dr. Ambedkar. Let us come to woman. Dr. Ambedkar was a law minister. He brought what is called Hindu Code Bill. Hindu Code Bill was giving equal right to woman, right to property, right to divorce, remarriage for the widows. So this all he brought in the Hindu Code Bill. And the Hindu opposed to Dr. Ambedkar. Even Hindu woman opposed to Ambedkar. I have given you the example of the victim of certain ideology supporting the same ideology, not knowing that this ideology is the reason for their deprivation. Some of the woman delegation went to Dr. Ambedkar that you are taking this Hindu Code Bill against Hinduism. And then he asked them, have you read this Hindu Code Bill? Then he told them, this is for your right. And then the woman confessed that, sorry, we were told that you are taking a step against Hinduism. They realized that Dr. Ambedkar was for the first time brought a Hindu Code Bill for the right of the woman. And the Congress government was, election was coming in 1952, and taking this political consideration into account, the Congress government at that time did not take the Hindu Code Bill wholly. They take it in installment. And when Ambedkar came to know as a law minister, he resigned as a law minister on the issue of women. The women of this country do not know that what they have is because of Ambedkar. Do they celebrate Ambedkar Jayanti other than the Dalit woman? No. The girls sitting here from the high caste, are they aware about it? This is the tragedy of this country, that they don't recognize his contribution for the development of the woman. All the right that women have now, the credit goes to Dr. Ambedkar. So you can see that the social policy for scheduled caste, scheduled tribe, and the woman, that credit goes to Dr. Ambedkar. Now the concept of reservation, concept of giving preference to discriminated community, this ideology also helped Muslim Christians to ask for the reservation. You must know that the scheduled caste converted to Sikhism, which are called must be Sikh, they got reservation, although they are Sikhs. The Neo-Buddhists in Maharashtra, although they converted to Buddhism, they got reservation, because in the constitution, reservation is only for Hindu scheduled caste. So the Buddhists got in 1991, but Sikh converted to Sikhism got in 1950 itself. But then the logic of reservation for the discriminated community and minority was used for asking for a preferential policy for Muslim, for Anglo-Indian and European. So to that extent, Ambedkar is responsible for developing policies for minorities, religious minorities. In fact, in the constitution, I will come to the constitution, there is a provision in the constitution for the minorities as such. The Sarchar committee, which has recommended policies, a sort of informal affirmative action policy, has a roots in the policy of reference given to the discriminated group, which include the minorities. Okay, so let me summarize this part, that why we have put this policy and practice issue for the Ambedkar workshop, because Ambedkar played a major role in developing policies for the minority discriminated group of scheduled caste, scheduled tribe, OBC, nomadic tribe, denominational tribe, woman, and religious minorities. That is the first point I want to make you clear so that you can read it. Second point is, what is the nature of this policy for the social group, ethnic group, minorities, and women? Now, to save on the time, the policies for the scheduled caste are scheduled caste and scheduled tribe and minorities and others are based on in the provision in the constitution. That you must realize. Because Dr. Ambedkar was the chairman of the drafting committee of the Indian constitution, and he saw to it that there are provision made for the discriminated communities and minority in the constitution. Therefore, I want to make you aware about the certain provision in the constitution on the basis of which the policies are developed now. The minority people and the social group and ethnic group and women draw justification from the constitution to develop the policies. What are the provision in the constitution? The first provision is that the Article 14 and 15, first provision is that the constitution recognizes equality. All are equal, irrespective of caste, religion, gender, sex, race, and residence. And everybody is equal before law. Law applies equally to everybody. Then equal opportunity. Then there is Article 15 also says that there will be no discrimination based on caste, religion, and other social identity. Ambedkar brought it very clearly. Not only equality, but mentioned discrimination also. Secondly, constitution ban untouchability and made it a punishable act. It says one of the highest order provision. The constitution itself ban untouchability. It also ban in a way discrimination based on gender, caste, ethnicity, religion, and other identities. Then there is a very important thing that you must remember, that it also make a provision for the minority, religious minority, that their culture will be preserved, that they will have a right to set up the educational institutions. This is very important provision, that minorities can set up the education institution. Therefore, today, the minorities have educational institutions set up by Muslims, by Christians, by Buddhists, by Sikhs, by Jain, and by others. That is as per the provision of the constitutions. Now, the second provision in the constitution, which you students should remember, is that the constitution not only recognize right to equality, equality before law, equal opportunity, principle of non-discrimination, but it also empower the state to take policies. That is very, very important. So Article 15.4 and Article 16 clearly laid down that, in the constitution laid down that nothing will stop the state government from developing policies, preferential policies for the certain social and religious group. It goes against the principle of inequality in a way, equality, because you are showing a favor to certain groups. But if the constitution justifies that special measure can be taken for those groups which are discriminated, which are lagging behind. It is under this provision that the various policies under reservation have been made. It made the part of the constitution. All credit goes to Dr. Peck. Then the Article 46, the directive principle. Directive principle is very, very important. You know, Dr. Ambedkar has, in a state and minority, which was a memorandum to the Constituent Assembly as to how should our constitution should be. In that, Dr. Ambedkar suggests socialism He suggests that we should have a socialist economy, wherein nationalization of land, nationalization of the public industries, the industry should be under the government, education should be run by the government, insurance should be government, and health should be government. So this was his state socialism concept. And he proposed democracy, parliamentary democracy and state socialism, and a society based on equality, fraternity, and justice. But the Constitution Assembly, particularly Patel, Rajendra Prasad, and Nehru, thought that defining our economic system, which is socialistic, and making it constitutional is not the practice. Dr. Ambedkar suggested constitutional state socialism as a matter of fact. Dr. Ambedkar argued that we are borrowing the concept of democracy from Britain, and they only define fundamental rights and the political system, that is parliamentary democracy and election, but they don't define what economic system should be adopted. The economic nature of the economic system is left to the legislature, to the parliament. And Dr. Ambedkar criticized, you know, that the parliament is dominated by the vested interest. They will never take policies in support of socialistic policy in support of the poor. Therefore, make it a part of the constitution and make it unamendable by anybody. So he wanted to make socialism constant, permanent as a part of constitution. It was not accepted. Therefore, Dr. Ambedkar brought Article 46, what is called directive principle. He borrowed it from the Irish constitution. And what is directive principle? Directive principle is nothing. It imposed a condition on the state. It required the state to take the policies, egalitarian policies, in a manner such that there won't be an inequality in income and the wealth and the development and the human development indicator. This is the broad condition. And then the second condition, that the policy should be particularly take for those groups which are discriminated, that the scheduled caste, scheduled tribe, and other groups in which there is a OBC, in other which there is a minorities, and he talk about social justice. So it is under the provision of 1946, Article 46, directive principle, that the people fights against the government, that constitution require us to make this provision. Now, this is the constitutional base of the policies for the discriminated community and even for the poor, to which Tauqeer Sabri has made a mention, labor. So this is the constitutional provision. Now, let us come to the actual policy. So I have dealt with two issues and you are make it clear to you. Now, what are the actual policies that we have for the discriminated group? And I won't talk about the labor and the poor because it will take more time, but I'll make a reference. The policies for the discriminated group for scheduled caste, scheduled tribe first is threefold, fourfold rather. First, that the constitution, of course, guaranteed the equality of citizenship right. Everybody has equal citizenship. But because of the caste discrimination in practice by the high caste, the untouchables, now called scheduled caste, are denied the equal right. And therefore, we have set up a law. The first policy is to frame a law against discrimination. If somebody refuses the equal right to the scheduled caste, then the scheduled caste can go to the court of law and get the rights. So the immediately after the constitution, two laws were passed. One is what is called Untouchability Offence Act, which was renamed as a Protection of Civil Rights Act in 1979. This act says that in all public places, the untouchable, the scheduled caste, we will have equal access. The civil, the political, economic, and everywhere, you know, rail, road, whatever, public sphere. I don't have a time. You please read that. There are about, I think, 25 to 30 public sphere which are identified by the act, where untouchable have equal access, and if somebody prohibit, they can go to the court. The second act was Prevention of Atrocity Act. This act, Protection of Civil Rights Act, when it was part practice and untouchable scheduled caste used to seek the equal right, try to get access to the whale, try to get access to the temple, they were attacked violently by the high caste. The atrocities were committed. Atrocities means violence and cruel act. Atrocities of various kinds were committed. I don't have a time to describe, but they are cruel. Therefore, the government in 89 brought a Prevention of Atrocity Act, under which now this act is was amended several times, but recently it was amended in 2015. And during Modi's Prime Minister Modi's government, this was passed. This was started by Congress, but it was passed during the Modi's government. There are 37 behavior of high caste which are considered as atrocious and subject to punishment. So legal protection, I don't go into that. You can go to the Google and you can download the Atrocity Act. You can download the PCR Protection of Civil Rights Act and you will get it. So legal protection against discrimination is provided through this act. Now I will talk later that the legal protection to the woman against gender discrimination is a follow-up of this act. The GSCAS, the law against gender discrimination is a follow-up of this. Dr. Ambedkar is responsible. Now, the second policy is the reservation policy. That the scheduled caste, Dr. Ambedkar thought that faced discrimination in job, private job, public job, in education institution. Therefore, a reservation policy was brought to give a fair share to the scheduled caste in government job, in education institution, and in legislation. So there is a reservation policy. It also now extends to public housing and other areas. There are some reservation in public enterprises also. That is another policy. The third aspect of the policy is to, because untouchable were denied right to property and right to enterprises by Manu, and that continued even till today. And therefore, there is a high percentage of landlessness among the scheduled caste and higher illiteracy. Therefore, a general policy was developed by the government, not the reservation and legal policy, but general policy as a part of the general policy to give land to the scheduled caste and to increase their ownership of enterprises. And also to provide certain scholarship and fellowship for the scheduled caste for their education development. So this is the policy for the scheduled caste and scheduled tribe, which exists today. It's all because of Dr. Ambedkar effort. Now, let us come to the other group. This policy was automatically extended to the tribals, nomadic tribe, and denotified tribe. So we have now, this government has set up their commission for denotified tribe. It is in R.K. Puram, the office is in R.K. Puram. Because the commission for scheduled caste and scheduled tribe was set up, as a follow-up of that, the commission was set up. You have to all, and Dr. Ambedkar suggests that there should be separate commission set up by the government. And this commission will set up, submit an annual report to the parliament and look into the complaint of discrimination. And it was done immediately in 1942. We have a commission for scheduled caste and scheduled tribe. Now it is separately for scheduled caste, separately for scheduled tribe. So on the same pattern, there is a commission for DNP, nomadic and demotivated. This is contribution of Dr. Ambedkar. Even DNP do not realize. Ambedkar is very, very isolated and excluded leader. And it's a tragedy that the people for whom he has done, they don't recognize it. Now, for women, he did this. Did a special thing, resigned as a law minister. So all the policies that we have now for the woman are the fallout of the Dr. Ambedkar's approach of developing a legal safeguard against discrimination based on gender and giving some space in job and in many areas. So what we have now for the woman, we have a law against gender discrimination and it is punishable. Very, very powerful act. And secondly, we have informal reservation policy. We don't have a formal reserve policy for women. But there are government directives that women should be given preference in job, women should be given in preference in legislature, women should be given preference in administrative position. But there is no formal policy, there is an informal policy. And I think this informal policy is very powerful. I can share with you as chairman of the University Grant Commission and a student of education that because of the informal policy for the woman to promote school education and higher education, you know, giving cycle, giving books, giving many things for women, girls, the enrollment ratio in the higher education of the woman has increased very rapidly. And the gap between the woman and the men has reduced now. If you look at the 2017 or 80s figure, the enrollment, the difference is only 2-3%. So the informal reservation policy for women has been quite successful in lifting them up. And there are other measures also. But it's all because of, again, Dr. Ambedkar's perspective and policy. Let's come to the religious minorities. Religious minorities, again, Dr. Ambedkar influences there and his policy has been carried forward. The first thing was that In 1952 itself, the Sikh Master Tara Singh talked to Nehru that if you exclude Sikhs from reservation, he saw a danger that all the scheduled caste will convert, Sikh will convert it to Hinduism to get the reservation. So he sort of threatened Nehru that you have to give a reservation to the scheduled caste converted to Sikhism. And Nehru agreed. Congress agreed. Therefore, the scheduled caste converted to Sikhism, which are called must be Sikh, get the reservation. So exception is made. Otherwise, reservation is only for Hindu scheduled caste. But here is a Sikh scheduled caste who get the reservation. Similarly, the Buddhist scheduled caste Buddhist converted into Maharashtra. Of the total Buddhists, 94% Buddhists are in Maharashtra. They are new Buddhists called. They are converted to Buddhism because of Dr. Ambedkar. They lost the reservation because they were not Hindu, they were Buddhists. So they remained without reservation from 1950 to 1991 when V.P. Singh and Paswan, Sri Paswanji, when they were in the government, they brought the reservation for the new Buddhists. It is not still implemented at the central level, but it is in Maharashtra. So new Buddhists also got the reservation. Now there is a issue of Muslims. Muslims do not have anything. But Satchar committee was set up. Satchar committee brought out that there are huge differences, inequality with the majority Hindu and majority and the minorities. And that inequality was brought out and there was policy developed. Now again, the Ambedkar's ideology, Ambedkar's policy suggestion came very handy to the Congress government, UPA 2, which developed the policies. At that time, for Muslim, the policy is they identified 90 districts in the country where the population of Muslim is reasonably high and the policy is developed. The policy is to provide the civic amenities, housing, electricity, drainage, and other policies. So the infrastructure development policy for the Muslim locality is a part of that. When I was chairman of the ICSR, Indian Council of Social Science Research, we were asked to make a review of the progress, 1 year progress of Satchar committee's recommendation. And I saw that there was some improvement that I do not know later on. But Muslim face discrimination in job and many other areas. There is no reservation. There are no studies also. I have looked at the percentage of regular salaried employee for the Muslim, it is the lowest. Low. I have seen the enrollment ratio in higher education of the Muslim, it is lower. It is lower than the scheduled caste even for that matter. It is on par with the scheduled tribe. So I do not want to go into that, but there is a policy, and that is a legacy of Dr. Ambedkar ideology. Now, this is the policy package for the marginalized group, which has been developed over a period of time, which is the result of the perspective and the solution given by Dr. Ambedkar. But generally, there is another point that I would like to mention and stop on this for a point, is that we have developed the policies of pro-poor policies. Indira Gandhi, for example, 20-point program of removal of poverty was there. Dr. Ambedkar also argued in 1952 and 51 the growth with social inclusion and for labor. You know, in 1942, that was the first plan in 1942, and Ambedkar was the member of the planning commission in 1942. He brought the concept of growth for we should be pro-labor because he was a labor minister at that time. So labor and pro-scheduled caste. Now, so we have a generally a policy of economic development, which is pro-poor and in general, irrespective of caste, religion. And as a part of that, not only Dalit, scheduled tribe and minority help, but the poor from non-scheduled caste, non-tribal, non-Muslim background also help. So poor from high caste, poor from OBC, poor from other advanced community also help. And we have developed policies for them. For example, Narega, everybody can get a job under Narega. Indira Awas Yojana, everybody can get a house irrespective of your caste background. Only thing that there is a certain quota for scheduled caste and scheduled tribe. So I think there is a general policy which is a pro-poor policy. World Bank talk about inclusive policy. Now they are talking about, you know, nobody should leave behind. Very popular phrase, share in prosperity. Is the new concept developed by the World Bank. But latest is nobody should leave behind. Nobody should leave behind. That means focus on poor, the economic policies. So friend, I have given you a general outline of the policy used by the government. I have not given you the background, the economic system, social system, nothing. I will make only one point that these policies has positive impact. The poverty of scheduled caste, scheduled tribe, and other minority has been reduced. There has been improvement in the educational development. There has been improvement in the ownership of land and enterprises. So there is a certain development. But I will end by saying that still the scheduled caste and scheduled tribe and the religious minority, only Muslim, they lag behind. I forgot to tell you one point that the scheduled caste converted to Christianity and scheduled caste converted to Muslim Islam, they are also asking for the reservation. Because they said that despite converging to Christianity and Islam, they face discrimination. Islam has not been able to overcome the discrimination of the scheduled caste and OBC. That is why OBC, Muslim OBC are part of the reservation of border OBC. But the scheduled caste converted to Christianity also face discrimination. And therefore, after 10 years, the church have developed the unaffordable action policy for the scheduled caste Christian. And the request of the Dalit Christian and the Dalit Muslim is with the Ministry of Social Justice and Empowerment. They have given evidence that how they are discriminated. So they should be also have a policy for reservation the way it is for the Sikh scheduled caste and Buddhist scheduled caste. So that point I had forgotten. So I was talking that although there has been improvement, there is an inequality between the high caste and the OB, high caste and the OBC and the scheduled caste and scheduled tribe persist. I will only mention that read my book, Dalit in India, read book by Vani, Vinod Mishra will give you a reference. Vinod Mishra is one of the author of that book. That there is an inequality in income per capita. Income per capita of the scheduled caste, scheduled tribe is lower than that of other. The poverty, their poverty is higher than that of highest caste. The share in the regular salary employment despite reservation is low. The access to civic amenity like housing, electricity and drinking water is low. Many speaker will speak about it. So disparity still persists. There has to be some changes in the policies so that development can be done. I will only say that there is a need for reform of the reservation policy. Reservation policy for scheduled caste, scheduled tribe is confined to only public sector. The public sector job only account 30% of the job, 70% of the job in the private where there is a discrimination. So reservation should be extended to private sector in employment and other. And there are other, there should be studies undertaken about the discrimination of the religious minority, particularly Muslim, Dalit Christian, Dalit Muslim, and policy of affirmative action should be developed. Policy for reservation for women should be developed. Women are asking for 30% reservation in legislature, rightfully. So the reservation policy and affirmative action policy also need to be changed. I hope the speaker will also discuss about this emerging issue for reform for the reservation policy. Okay, thank you very much, Dr. Vinod Mishra. I hope I have not taken more time.
No, sir, you have time.
No, thank you, sir. Thank you, sir, for giving a broad perspective how, you know, policy frame, not only as just a glimpse, also you have put it, you know, historical context, political context, sociological context, and what happened also in the contemporary India regarding the policy, who and how policy can twist and who can include and who can exclude. So you have given broad perspective on that. I'm sure our scholar can find interesting, and they can think what is the broader policy, and they can also add very beautifully. You also not gone far from that. You mentioned how NREGA, you know, Indira Awas Yojana, all are there as a policy, and that's also the different kind of myth has been happening in India. The policy has been only framed for one caste, one group. So that's many policies are for all. So that's kind of the, also the take for all of us to understand and ponder. And I'm sure in later session, Professor Thorat will take question. Now we are not able to take question because we are already late, and this was the kind of a keynote speak from him. Many thanks for you. always guiding us, mentoring us throughout our journey for last 3 years in this Ambedkar Summer School. And I hope in this Ambedkar Summer School, sir will take some questions in later stage. Thanks a lot, sir.
Pleasure, Toki. Yeah, it's always a pleasure to participate.
Thank you, sir. We are closing and for the
team. Yeah. Give me a phone call when you need me. Huh?
Sure, sir.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.